What's up, everyone? Today, the video is going to be an intro to the music of Anthony Braxton. Braxton is one of the greatest geniuses of American music. You could say maybe music of all time. But he's been a major inspiration to me, even though you wouldn't really hear it in my music, at least not in the recent years. I had the distinct privilege of getting to study with him and play with him when I was at Wesleyan as an undergrad. So he's just marinating in his realm, just a super formative to me. And I have a sort of hands-on knowledge of what his music is and what it's about. So let's get into who Anthony Braxton is. Anthony Braxton is primarily known in the jazz world as an alto saxophonist and multi-reeds player, flute, clarinet, all the different flutes, all the different saxophones. He's known as a virtuoso. He's controversial in the jazz world for reasons that we'll see as the video goes on, but he is known as a major innovator of the instrument. He was born in 1945 in Chicago, on the south side of Chicago, and he came up through this organization called the AACM. The AACM stands for the Association for the Advancement of Creative Musicians, and that was a collective that was devoted to cultivating this kind of American experimentalism. A distinctly black experimentalism. It's an all-black organization and remains so to this day. But it's devoted to an American creative experimental music that is coming out of improvised music, i.e. jazz, but they sort of take it, they don't call it jazz, they call it creative music. John Coltrane, Archie Shepp, Albert Eiler, Cecil Taylor for sure, moving that into new directions, exploring new possibilities of what to do with improvised music in the 60s, and in many ways combining it with elements of European post-war, you know, post-World War II modernist experimental avant-garde composition. Karlheinz Stockhausen, Pierre Boulez, Yanis Xenakis, and also the American, coming out of American, but post-European composers such as John Cage, of course, and Morton Feldman, and Earl Brown. The AACM is founded in 1965 by composer Muhal Richard Abrams. Abrams is kind of like the father figure of this group. Some of the other just absolute colossal musicians that came out of the AACM include Roscoe Mitchell, Wadada Leo Smith, Leroy Jenkins, and the association continues to this day with artists like Tamika Reid, who I also can name drop that I know a little bit. So this is what Braxton comes out of when he's like 20. He joins the AACM. Braxton's seminal early record that he's really known for off the bat, it's his second record, is called For Alto. This is a record of all alto saxophone. It came out, it's solo alto sax. It came out in 1969 when he was 24 years old, and he comes out with this record that basically redefined the instrument. It's these solo pieces that are highly focused studies in very specific sound worlds. So these aren't free improvisations where he's just playing completely free variety of stuff, but they aren't compositions in the sense of every note being written out either. There had been barely any solo saxophone records made. Coleman Hawkins made one, apparently, and there have been a few other ones, but really barely any, and none had been made in the 60s avant-garde jazz realm. when you listen to this music on four alto, you're hearing stuff coming out of John Coltrane, late Coltrane, you know, the sort of relentless sheets of sound. But what those sheets of sound are is pretty new. You're hearing unique stuff, like you're hearing these crazy intervals, wide intervallic leaps. The only person who had really been doing that was Eric Dolphy on the saxophone. And he also, you're also the thing that Braxton really is known for that he lays down here and that kind of was controversial throughout his career is his staccato, his use of staccato tonguing, okay? This might, if you're not really deep in jazz or experimental music, this might sound like, well, who cares? But that is just a thing that he really brought from, he brought into improvised music and the jazz world, this very non-jazz element of just like, and you also still hear the blues, absolutely, still completely rooted in the blues. This was controversial, but it, undeniably a monumental statement just as an innovative thing on the instrument. Now, when I said that these pieces on four alto have these very focused sound worlds, what I'm really talking about is that as compositions, what he's determined is he's focusing on certain sonic categories that he's defined ahead of time. And he calls these language musics. He loves music in the plural, musics. And I don't know all the ins and outs of how he employs this idea on this on four alto, but he has these sonic categories that are numbered. And like one of them would be long tones, sustained tones. The other would be staccato notes. Another would be trills. Another would be slightly more abstract stuff like gradient formings. That's a language that he has, meaning some parameter is increasing and decreasing gradually. So a gradient forming could mean speed. Things are getting faster and slower gradually, or things are gradually getting higher and lower. You know, so that's sort of more abstract language. Noise elements, that's a language music. These planned out sonic categories that don't ha they don't have to do with notes, they don't have to do with pitch or harmony, but they're dealing with categories of sound that come out of free improvisation in 1960s avant-garde jazz. So it's like, so you know, so he's coming out of this realm and he starts to catalog, methodically catalog and describe things that he's already doing and that his collaborators are already doing on the instrument. So we can define them and make them into sort of compositions. These language musics, they're particularly obvious in the solo music because he just focuses on these sounds. But he ends up using this idea of these categories of language music throughout his body of work, and they can be applied in different ways that I'll talk about later. Another thing that makes four alto, at least to my ears, that makes it so innovative and such a leap forward, or you could say a leap off to the side from jazz, is that it's not just the sounds that he's using and the techniques, but it's also the way the music unfolds, or I guess you could say doesn't unfold. With so much free jazz and that sort of ecstatic 60s music, it's all about these building up to these peaks and then these rising and falling, where it's sort of like a dramatic arc. You know, if you've ever done free improvisation, these jams, you know how that goes. You build up to a climax and then you come down. Four alto is way more of this detached sort of studies vibe, where it's like, there's a lot of fierce, passionate playing, but it's kind of framed as like we are exploring this block of material, you know? So it doesn't have that same kind of narrative romantic doesn't have that romanticism to it. It has that sort of objective, steely, sort of way that things, there's clinical sounds negative because it's anything but clinical, but there is that highly composed sort of etude studies feeling to it that makes it gives it this connection to the European avant-garde, which is one of the things I love about it. Okay, so it's hard to really break his whole career up into really clearly defined phases, but I'm going to try to give these sort of signposts of phases and aspects of his work. So let's say for the 1970s, I think a really good entry point for that time is this record just called New York Fall 1974. And this is him with a small group with a few different musicians on different tracks. He's got trumpeter Kenny Wheeler, bassist Dave Holland, and a drummer Jerome Cooper, and then he's got some of the players from the World Sax Quartet, the other saxophonists. He's got Hamiet Blewett and Oliver Lake. And this stuff, he's already thinking in such an original way that the titles of these pieces are, you can't even say them because they're pictures. They're like graphic pictures with numbers and letters. Let's listen to this next track. So here, what you're hearing is a total unison of all the instruments. Total unison, completely composed. I mean, you can tell there's no improvisation here. It's just one line. And you hear how this is not, it's not as, you know, as aggressive or quote unquote far out as this four alto stuff. It's not dissonant or super angular. It is sort of harmonically, melodically, it has a lot of in common with Ornette Coleman. There's some classic bebop, Charlie Parker elements in there. he's very into Lenny Tristano. Lenny Tristano was a contemporary of Charlie Parker, a pianist, who's totally underrated, sort of cult jazz guy, really worth checking out. Braxton got a lot of people into Tristano. But you notice how this stuff, it doesn't swing. This does not have a swinging beat behind it. It is harmonically sort of like jazz, but it doesn't swing, and it's also got that staccato element. So, I mean, this kind of would appeal to prog fans of prog rock, I think, like this, you know? And, you can hear how this is, it's jazz, but it's not jazz in many ways. This next piece is quite different. This next piece does have swinging in it, swing feel. So you can hear Braxton playing with some more recognizable jazz elements. Check this one out. This is, you hear Braxton playing over swing feel, and you know, does he swing? Is he swinging? You know, this is something that jazz purists could argue about forever. When Coltrane first came out, even before he went to his late period, even when he was just playing in Miles Davis's group in the 50s, critics off the bat said, this he doesn't swing, you know? Yeah, he's a virtuoso, but this doesn't swing. And that was simply because Train was playing a lot of 16th notes instead of all 8th notes. You know, he was just playing a double time, So to them, that didn't swing. I mean, it didn't swing hard enough, you know, like, so Coltrane caught shit for that. And then, of course, you know, by the time he dies, he's considered one of the greatest ever, which he was, and he's considered very much part of the jazz tradition. So Braxton, it's another controversial thing. Does this swing? He clearly is playing ball with the swing feel, but he's just so jagged and just departing from it. And it's just like he's got so many different rhythmic feels just going on at the same time, and all just these tangential rhythmic directions going on. So, but yes, this is him. He definitely, and he has swing feel recurring through his whole body of work. Even up toward the end, he has passages that swing like this. Okay, this third piece, which you just heard a segment of, another graphically represented title that can't be spoken. This represents, I don't know what you would call this, but there's this kind of, I would call it the fragile side of Braxton. And it's really the fragile side of the AACM too. If you listen to some of Roscoe Mitchell's early stuff, Roscoe Mitchell is another one of the great AACM artists. He has a lot of stuff where he's just playing these tiny little chirping sounds. There's a lot of silence, some like toy instruments. And this stuff is not quite as minimal as the Roscoe stuff, but you hear there's this kind of, he's not afraid to deflate the energy, you know? All I can call it is a sort of a fragility here. Just letting things sit and be awkward or weird in a way, you know? He's not always pushing the sounds around. And this, you know, he comes out of Morton Feldman, who's very much like that. He's not afraid to leave a certain passivity there. So we checked out Braxton's early solo stuff and then his 70s small group stuff. He also has a ton of large ensemble music for, and often he calls it creative orchestra music. For him, a creative orchestra means a large ensemble made up of musicians who are also improvisers, creative improvisers in their own right. And they're usually playing music that integrates improvisation and composition, you know? And integrating composition and improvisation is really, I mean, that's the whole thing with the AACM, and that's just a deep concern for Braxton throughout his entire career. And with the creative orchestra music, you can hear different ways that he does that. He has large ensemble stuff from many different phases of his work. So check out this. This is from this record called Creative Orchestra Music 1976. Okay. It's got Roscoe Mitchell and a bunch of other great AACM artists on it. This has some influences you will not even expect. Check this out. Got the creative improvisation elements. You've got the composed modernist elements, and then you've got circus music. This is something that Braxton has been into from day one, apparently circus music and the marches of John Philip Sousa.
Thank you.
So you just heard an excerpt from a 1989 record, large ensemble creative orchestra record, just entitled Eugene 1989. I think these musicians might be students. I'm not sure. Students at the University of Oregon, Eugene. Maybe not. Maybe they're pros, but I didn't recognize any of them. In any case, composition 112, you hear this. This is way more dense. This is way more what you think of when you think of Stockhausen or Xenakis. Super dissonant, super dense, super thick. The orchestra is split into different groups doing very different things. And what you hear here is people playing very complex lines that are completely composed in unison, you know, lines that are as complicated as his improvisations, you know, as angular, as irregular, you know, crazy intervals and everything. Fully notated, people are playing them in unison while all this other stuff is going on. There's a lot of his music, as we'll talk about in a sec, deals a lot with completely different things happening simultaneously. He gets that from Charles Ives and elsewhere, and Stockhausen and Cage, taking things that were not written together, that were not conceived of together, separate compositions, and having them be played simultaneously and just allowing that the results to happen. That's a big part of his large ensemble music, and it's a big part of basically all his music from the 80s forward. Okay, modular compositions, or composition as an approach. We talked about the language music approach of defining stuff for semi-improvised music. I talked about the 70s where he's, we talked about the aesthetics of that 70s music, but we didn't really talk about how he's integrating improvisation and composition on a specific technical level. And we haven't talked about this, how that's going to relate to his use of modular compositions and what that means. So modular compositions, basically, it just means that he's got different compositions that can just be combined with what he calls an erector set or a construction set. That was a thing like in the 60s that kids would play with, an erector set. It's like it's like Legos, essentially. And that's how he treats a lot of his compositions. You know, a set of music or a record will be composition 103 plus composition 84B plus composition 406, you know, and these pieces will be strung together and plugged into each other in this modular way where they can be rearranged. So there's this sort of unpreciousness to this music that owes a lot to all his influences, as we've discussed. So, but before even talking about how these things can be used modularly, just what does an Anthony Braxton composition look like? Well, they all, you know, there's a great variety of how they look, but 80s and 90s, you're looking at pieces of music where it'll often be not specified what instrument it's for, you know? I mean, there's a lot of stuff where it's just a bunch of different instruments, but any instrument could play any part. And a lot of the time the clef is not specified, which means that essentially the notes are not specified. I mean, you're reading notes, and so you're reading these, you're reading it on your instrument, but it's going to be completely different notes if you're playing it on a trumpet versus playing it on an E-flat clarinet or something. So you've got this thing where, harmony is not being dealt with in that sort of, you know, tonal way, or even, you know. So that's an aspect. A lot of his stuff it'll be some really, really complexly written, like fully notated, modern classical looking, difficult little runs. No, you know. Then that will connect to, you know, one measure of complete free improvisation where you fill it in. Then the next couple measures will be more hyper, completely written, hyper complex stuff. Then there'll be a sort of squiggly shape thing that you're supposed to interpret, you know, so you improvise, but you interpret the shape. And then there might be a little arrow where you have an option, After that, there's an option to exit and play some other composition that you have on your menu. So it's that kind of thing where you've got, even within a composition, there are all these little areas of doing different stuff. And then there's little exit points where things connect to other compositions. And sometimes you've got four people playing one composition and then moving into other compositions as a group. Sometimes you've got one person breaking off and playing a completely separate composition and then going into completely free improvisation for a long time. You've got just all these different subgroups forking off into different pieces that he's written ahead of time. Reading through his music, which I did, in large ensemble and small ensemble stuff at Wesleyan, it's like a difficult video game, but like really fun, but like on hard mode. Like you're just, you can't settle into one psychology of, okay, I'm playing this difficult stuff. You have to play difficult stuff and then be creative and then be half creative and then play more difficult stuff and then, think about some language music thing that's connecting to some other thing. It's, the kind of attention that that modular approach requires, there's this psychology that you get into playing this that is like beyond just getting a result. There's a resultant vibe to it. There's this energy of people thinking that way while they're playing. There's a very particular intensity to it that is just totally unique. And so, yes, this modular thing, I keep saying it's not precious. And I guess by that, I mean that it's like he's aspiring to this realm of music that is just such an utterly ambitious, artistic goal. And yet there isn't this sense of any one composition being like, this is the masterpiece, like get ready for the masterpiece. They're all numbered, each one is just numbered and they plug into each other. And you don't recognize, I mean, he doesn't have hits, you know what I mean? Like they're all very self-similar. So it's like constructing this world that you just exist in. And like I said, with Charles Ives, the modular thing, there's the simultaneity thing where you have completely separate compositions going on at the same time. And that just creates just these insanely complex results. Also, another thing that's interesting about Braxton that really makes his stuff work so well is that his notated music, the stuff that he threw composes notation, it's completely the same kind of stuff that he improvises. So it's like aesthetically, there isn't a difference between how he improvises and how he writes music. So when it's him or when it's someone who is playing his music and interpreting it right. When you're going in and out of playing a written thing and then doing your little improvisation, like coming out of it and then going back, it's all seamless. It all has the same quality to it. It's just you're going in and out of different psychology, but it all holds together. And it that's different than a lot of, there are, I don't want to name names and be critical, but there are a lot of other musicians like coming out of jazz or improvised music where, when they get commissioned to write something for an orchestra or they get commissioned to write something for a string quartet, they'll write stuff that sounds totally different than their improvisation. Maybe their improvisation is like super abstract and atonal, but then when they sit down to write a string quartet, it sounds like Debussy or something. It's like totally different. Braxton is like, he's just doing him in both ways, whether it's improvised, composed, or somewhere in between. It's always this sort of similar language. And if we're talking about that sort of unified, that sense of a very unified aesthetic, that's a very different kind of modular. When people think of, or when I think of something being modular, I sort of think of difference, juxtaposing difference, but that's not what he's going for. It's not like, I'm a huge John Zorn fan. John Zorn, it's all about these modules that are, it's like that, what they used to call postmodernism, right? Where you just have these this quilt, a patchwork of different things, and the energy comes from just the shock of difference. This is completely not that. This is modular things that are adding up to a complete, to a unified, a sense of a very unified aesthetic. Also on the topic of his use of modular approaches, this is one of the coolest things. Remember we talked about the language musics, where he has these categories of sound. He'll take those language musics categories and apply them to different compositions, like notated compositions. So he'll say we're going to play composition 105, but we're going to play it quote unquote in the house of language music 5, let's say. So it's like, and the language 5 is trills. So it's like, we're going to play this notated composition in the house of trills. And so you play the whole piece making everything a trill. And sometimes it's really hard to do that because you have to do all this interpretation. Like, how do I make this thing a trill? But you trying to do that generates these really cool results that you wouldn't have come to. Let's do composition, 84 in the house of the staccato thing. So then the whole thing is staccato. So even the language categories have a modular approach where you can apply those. It's like a filter, it's like a Photoshop filter. Like, oh, we're going to put the grace note filter. We're going to put the trill filter over this piece and make it all trills. It's so sick. Okay, so if we're going to talk about modular compositional approaches, now we're getting into the 80s. Braxton's phase in the 80s and early 90s, this is kind of considered like his classic period. Not that it's necessarily the best, but it's like his... He hit a certain kind of stride because he had this quartet, Anthony Braxton's quartet in the 80s. It's kind of like a classic jazz band, in the sense of like John Coltrane's classic quartets. The first one with Elvin Jones and McCoy Tyner, and then the other one with Rashid Ali and Alice Coltrane. Or like Miles Davis's 60s quartet with Herbie Hancock and Wayne Shorter, Tony Williams, or Miles Davis's bands in his quintet in the 50s. Braxton's 80s quartet is like one of those groups. It's got Marilyn Crispell on piano and Jerry Hemingway on drums, Mark Dresser on the bass. These are all not only just the deepest, most deepest virtuoso players, but they really are like serious scholars of his music. I don't know if scholars is the right word, but they're like, this is like a unit. This is like a SWAT team. This is where he's doing like the most modular stuff. He's dealing with the groups separating into subgroups. Sometimes you have everyone playing a notated piece together. Sometimes you've got two people playing one notated piece together, the other two people playing another notated piece together, and they're both just happening simultaneously. Sometimes all four people are just improvising together. Sometimes all four people are playing separate notated compositions. And again, because his notated music and the improvising all is so aesthetically one, you end up with a set of music or a record from this quartet is just this meditative thing of like an hour long thing of just going into these different realms. Some of them have a little bit more of a tight composed vibe to them. Some of it feels a little bit more free. Most of it exists in this interspace with these weird surprises of things happening at the same time. There is nothing like that. This quartet, I wish I could have seen them. I was a child, so I wouldn't have. They also toured a ton. I mean, that's why they were just like tour tight constantly. It's like a real band. They were road dogs. And as far as records to check out, the one we just listened to was it's from 1985. It's just called Quartet London 1985. It's on the Leo label. But basically anything from the 80s that's on the labels Soul Note or Black Saint or Hat Art is another label, or Leo, Yeah, there's just a bunch of different records of the quartet, just tons of them from the 80s and early 90s on those labels. Okay, so just when you thought our plate was completely full, you get into the 90s and you're looking at this set of music that he calls ghost trance music. Ghost trance music is based on this kind of pulse that you heard in that example. It's like this repetitive pulse with these interruptions. You could say it's influenced by American minimalism to some extent. I think his idea of ghost trance, I think, comes from something about from Native American music or culture. I don't quote me on that, but I think I've heard him say that. The ghost trance thing, you can play it at any speed. You can apply different language musics to it. You can do a ghost trance in the house of trills, ghost trance in the house of legato or staccato, or with noise elements. And of course, huge group, you can have a subgroup doing a bunch of ghost trance stuff. You got a bunch of other people doing ghost trance at a different speed, slowing up and speeding down, slowing down and speeding up. It can be a connector material between two fully composed pieces. It's just a whole new direction he went in the 90s that just is combined with all his old compositions and just is more modules to put in the Erector set. So the most monumental stuff he's been doing since then is this series of operas. He's been writing this entire cycle of operas. The real values that are being embraced in this time period have nothing to do with self-realization and spirituality. We have come to value only money and false images at the expense of inner peace and purpose. This has been going on for quite some time now. He's really influenced by Wagner, obviously. And the entire thing is called the Trillium series. And there's apparently it goes through the whole alphabet, Trillium A, B, C through D, through Z. But he's doing them out of order. The first one that he wrote was Trillium R. I'm not sure where he's at in the alphabet. I don't know a whole lot about this music. It has been documented. I've never seen it performed, but I know that it is very ritual and ceremonial. Costumes are a big part of it. I mean, he has visuals, dance, movements, and I believe that it's taking a lot of his compositional ideas to the next level of drama. I know that, yeah, he's really, I mean, he taught a course called Sun Ra and Stockhausen at Wesleyan. So there's a lot of, he's really combining those two worlds, Sun Ra. Braxton has interest in outer space and a certain sci-fi element. And there's a real utopian vision with his stuff. I mean, the little that I've heard of the operas, he has a very positive sense of like the future of humanity and a better world. Evolution. There's a positivity to it. His philosophy, he has this idea called the tricentric philosophy. I'm not even going to get into it because it's very esoteric, but very real. It's based around the number three. He's into numerology in an ancient sort of sacred way of numerology, sense of number. If you want to learn about his own, in his own words, his philosophy and just ways of talking about his own music, there's something called the Tri-Axiom Writings, and there's also something called just Composition Notes by Anthony Braxton. Both of those things, I mean, if you want to just go really cult on Anthony Braxton, read those two things. There's also a book by Graham Locke called Forces in Motion. If you want to read all about Braxton, Forces in Motion is the book to check out. So, you know, as far as Braxton's role in culture and just the sort of implications of his work socially, politically, culturally, just how it's been received, how it functions in the world of jazz and classical music, it's very strange because on one level, he's regarded and accepted as an absolute genius. But in many ways, he's also been slighted, I think, and he definitely thinks so, by these various worlds, because he has always existed between worlds. He doesn't want to be just a composer or just an improviser. He doesn't want to be just a jazz musician or just a classical composer. He doesn't want to, it's not about, you know, Europe versus Africa. He said, I want Europe and Africa and Asia and everywhere and this and that. He loves the word and. It's a modular view of the world. You know, it's not a thing of reconciling opposites, you know? This is not dialectical, you know? It's the kind of attitude where it's almost assumed that opposites are reconciled ahead of time and things aren't even viewed as opposites. Synthesis is almost a given. He's a very patriotic person, actually. He talks about America a lot. He loves America, and he considers what he does to be very American music, and so do I. And jazz is a very distinctly American music. Jazz is a hybrid music. Rock and roll is a hybrid music. This kind of hybridity is distinctly American. The fact that the sort of the jazz establishment has had such an ambivalent relationship with him, that I think it hurt him a lot, because it seems like to him, the fact that he departed from jazz is in a way the most jazz thing that you can do, in a way leaving the tradition, i.e. expanding the tradition, i.e. contaminating the tradition, is in the tradition, because he doesn't even call it jazz, he calls it creative music. Of course, you know, he means jazz is what, you know, he is coming out of that, but, you know, In the very first place, in the bebop era, that was already taking African blues elements and incorporating European elements, digesting all of both and just making a completely new hybrid. So he just kept doing that and going further. And for some reason, jazz people couldn't hang. There's a lot of political stuff to that because he caught shit in the 80s from... critics like Stanley Crouch, who's revered as this jazz critic. I don't know, Ken Burns' documentary on jazz, you know, has Stanley Crouch in it a lot. Stanley Crouch and Wynton Marsalis, that sort of 80s Lincoln Center jazz crew went out of their way to disrespect him. And I find it galling, actually. But the thing is, I mean, there is a sort of racial politics to it. Wynton Marsalis and Stanley Crouch and these people that sort of trash Braxton, they say he's not really jazz, he can't really swing, he doesn't really play the blues. They're saying he's not black enough, you know, and he has said this. He said, I'm not considered black enough for jazz, I'm not considered white enough for classical. Yeah, I met Wynton Marsalis once. He was... very dismissive, but I mean, that's neither here nor there. I mean, there are plenty of reasons to dismiss 17-year-old me. So, you know, there are these ways that Braxton has had a problematic relationship with the jazz establishment. As far as the classical music establishment, I don't think he was ever as embroiled in the sort of polemics and the politics of criticism, but a way in which his music is really challenging to... what was the sort of orthodoxy of classical music, even the orthodoxy of modern post-war avant-garde classical music, is that he uses and is rooted in improvisation, which it's weird because, you know, he was coming out of Earl Brown, John Cage, Christian Wolff, Morton Feldman, the New York school of composers, who, you know, those composers were using new notations and approaches to use indeterminacy in the music. All right, they were big on unlocking indeterminacy, indeterminate elements, getting elements that are not planned out, not written out ahead of time to be in the music. John Cage uses chance, rolling dice, using the I Ching, using silence to allow the sounds in the environment to come in. See, Braxton and all the AACM people, they were coming out of that, but the thing is, they had a thing. They weren't talking about indeterminacy. They're talking about improvisation. And Braxton talked about this quite a bit in some of his talks, lectures that I saw, where there's a difference there to, as far as just like the fact that classical composers and a lot of that New York school, I think Cage specifically, sort of looked down on improvisation, and they made it very clear, we're not into improvisation, we are into indeterminacy. And Braxton, to an extent, has said that there is a racial or political element to that, where improvisation is seen as lower, lesser, you know, coded in a certain way, indeterminacy somehow being higher. So there's something particularly radical about Braxton using the these sort of alternative notations, though, that were sort of coming out of the New York School, Cage and stuff, and coming out of Stockhausen, Xenakis, post-World War II European composers. This expansion of notation to include non-predetermined elements, but to invite the musicians to engage in that in a way that was more actively creative in the sense of being an improviser. So not only does that sort of have roots in jazz, and therefore has this sort of like this political, racial, political aspect to it, it also calls for a different kind of a player to an extent. I mean, to play Braxton's music well, you have to be able to nail the notated music, and you have to be able to bring active creative improvisation to it. The indeterminacy isn't just a sort of passive, hands-off-the-wheel kind of element. It's an element where you have to be engaging in a more active way. This doesn't mean that he's been shunned by classical music because of that, but I think that sort of, that whole issue of improvisation has made it, I think, just harder for him to just operate in that world or be considered part of that world. But a lot of this has, to a large extent, come out in the wash, because you know how it is. Great artists later in life, and then after they die, especially, people stop breaking their balls and they actually embrace them and give them awards and stuff. But yes, Braxton is fully alive and he's getting his due. It's long overdue, but he is getting his due. Something I think a lot about with Braxton's music is this issue of like the particular versus the universal. And Braxton really is, his music is really aspires to the universal. There's a sense of universality that he's going for, you know? He talks about how he doesn't want to make idiomatic music. He calls his music trans-idiomatic. Now, see, for me, this is a weird thing, because when I hear his music, I mean, it is very much coming out of certain idioms. You hear jazz in it, you hear post-war avant-garde European music in it, and you hear some of the circus music elements and some other idioms. So, I mean, I wonder if any music can be truly trans-idiomatic. You know, I mean, all music is some kind of composite of the languages that it springs out of, you know? But aspiring to something that is trans-idiomatic, that goes beyond all languages, that kind of universality as an artistic goal or a spiritual, philosophical goal, there is just something to that is so heavy and profound. I'm not saying that all great art necessarily aspires to that kind of universality. I mean, I think it's just certain types of artists, certain particular artists that have that kind of concept. But it is a particular power to that, you know, like his language musics, the idea of, you know, he said that he wants to, that language musics could be applied to any scenario, any creative scenario, his sonic categories. of course, the sonic categories themselves in a lot of ways come out of just the idioms that he comes out of. So, I mean, in a way, they're very particular to what he has done, but this intention to have it apply universally is something that not only is it deep, but it's sort of, I wonder if it's, you could say it's less and less common. I don't know how to measure that, but nowadays there's a lot of distrust of the idea of universals. You know, just the, what we used to call postmodernism, you know, that's not so much of a term anymore, but it that still is sort of this condition that we live in where there's this distrust of the idea of an overarching narrative, an overarching way that things are, a system of meaning that applies to everything, a system of language that applies to everything. That's more on trial now than it's ever been, I think, as far as I can tell. So there is something deeply inspiring, though, about work that has this aspiration to the universal. In a sense, the idea of a universal language, trans-idiomatic music, I guess you could call that sort of modernist in a way. It is kind of reminiscent, just that idea of serialism, which, you know, those composers that clearly Braxton loves, you know, European tradition of 20th century, you know, serialism and sort of process-based music, composition like that. But it's an interesting thing the way Braxton is on the one hand, he has that this high modernist sort of thrust toward the idea of universality, but then he's also so distinctly American in his valuing of hybridity and multiplicity and modular combining of the and, you know, this and that. I'm not even going to say there's a tension there, but it's, those are sort of, to me, those are things that I think of differently. For Braxton, those are not different things. For Braxton, this sort of additive thing of a quilt, a patchwork, an assemblage, an erector set, a set of Legos, a composite of modules stitched together in different ways. For him, that multiplicity does point towards a universality. In the end, Braxton is a very utopian thinker. I mean, his vision, it really is a 60s thing. So much of the creative improvised music of the 60s was about freedom, free jazz, free music. Whereas he sort of was like, okay, we've established freedom. Now we're going to funnel that freedom into all kinds of rigorous discipline. And it's going to be even more free for that, you know? Like I said, even though my music has basically nothing to do with Braxton aesthetically at this point, you know, I mean, some of my recent stuff just like basically sounds like Depeche Mode, but not as far as specific aesthetics, but just as far as just the idea of his vision of what it means to have a body of work and what it means to be a musical artist just remains fundamentally ingrained in who I am and is just so deep to me. Just even the phrase body of work, he got me into that. You know, just this idea that it's not about every little precious thing that you put out. It's about your corpus, you know, and creating a realm that people can just enter into. And it's just like this forest of stuff. I mean, that's what John Zorn taught me. Justin Broadrick taught me that. He's a little bit less grandiose in the way he would talk about himself, but he's one of those guys for sure. Hopefully this has given you a sense of how to enter Anthony Braxton. It's hard, but you know, there's many portals in and there's many portals out, you know, it's modular. All right. Thanks for listening. I'll see everybody next time.